Would you dance if I asked you to dance? Would you run and never look back? Would you cry if you saw me crying? And would you save my soul tonight? Would you tremble if I touched your lips? Would you laugh? Oh, please tell me this. Now would you die for the one you love? Hold me in your arms tonight. I can be your hero, baby. I can kiss away the pain. I will stand by you forever. You can take my breath away. Would you swear that you'll always be mine? Or would you lie? Would you run and hide? Am I in too deep? Have I lost my mind? I don't care, you're here tonight. I can.
On behalf of Glenda, Katie, and Justin and their families, I welcome you and thank you for your presence here today. Your presence is not only an indication of the high esteem in which you hold Garry Mallen, but also an indication of your love and support for the family. So thank you for coming. My name is David Poole, and I'm a CFA chaplain and have the privilege and honour of leading you through this service. As part of the protocol of this fire service funeral and as a mark of respect, a guard of honour will be assembled in the street outside the hall at the conclusion of the service. The CFA chief officer, senior CFA leaders, members of Portland Fire Brigade will form an honour guard immediately outside the hall. Others can join in the guard of honour once the Portland members are in place. Please follow the directions of the guard of honour marshal, who will assist you and be on hand. Now I'd like to invite Terry Hayfield, Commander Terry Hayfield, to come and inform us of some housekeeping items. Thanks, Terry.
Thank you, David, and welcome everyone for your attendance here today on this special day, the funeral of Garry Mallen. I'd just like to go through a bit of information for you before the ceremony gets underway. So if you can just bear with me for a moment. In case of an emergency, if any evacuation is needed, we have the exits either side of the building or through the main entrance. So if you could just make sure you're aware of your exits. I'd also like to let you know that this ceremony is being live streamed across the world through the CFA's YouTube channel. And there will be photographers also taking photos of the ceremony. For your convenience, there's toilets outside the foyer, just to the right-hand side of the building. And lastly, there's a couple of other things. Can I ensure that everyone has their mobile phones turned off or to silent? Thank you. After the ceremony, there'll be the wake. The family would love to have everyone back to the wake at Alexandra Park in Park Street, Portland. And I thank everyone for their cooperation. Can we now please stand for the presentation of the colour party?
Thank you.
Please be seated. Today I'd like to acknowledge and welcome a number of guests. Firstly, MP Jacinta Ermacora, representing Jacqueline Symes, Attorney General, Emergency Services Minister. Unfortunately, the Glenelg Shire Councillor, Mayor Karen Stevens, is not able to be with us and sends her apology. We welcome CFA board members, Rosemary Martin, and Peter Shaw, AFSM, representing Mr. Greg Wilson, the Chair of the CFA Board, and also representing other board members. CFA Chief Officer Jason Heffernan, CFA Chief Executive Officer Natalie MacDonald, Emergency Management Victoria Commissioner Rick Nugent, Fire Rescue Victoria Commissioner Gavin Freeman, AFSM, Chief Executive Officer, Volunteer Fire Brigades Victoria, Adam Barnett. President of the Volunteer Fire Brigades Victoria, Samantha Collins. Deputy Chief Officer, Alistair Drayton, AFSM, representing SES Chief Executive Officer, Greg Leach, AFSM, and Chief Officer Operations, Tim Winebush. Deputy Chief Officer Joe Gomez, representing Chief Fire Officer Chris Hardman. Superintendent Simon Stevens, representing the Police Chief Commissioner Shane Patton. Assistant Chief Fire Officer District 4 John Jugum, AFSM. Porton Fire Brigade Captain Ryan Delony. Senior CFA officers and other officers representing other agencies. Welcome and thank you for your attendance. We're here today to remember, to give thanks for, to pay our respects to say goodbye to, and to reflect upon the life of Garry Mallen, who has died. We're here because in one way or another, this death affects us all. We are here to give support and comfort to those who grieve the loss of a husband, a son, a father-in-law, a grandfather, a brother-in-law, an uncle, a relation, a fellow CFA volunteer, and a good friend. And so our thoughts and prayers today are especially with Glenda, Katie, Justin, and their families. Saying farewell is never easy. We will naturally be upset and sad and may cry. There are many ways in which we gain strength, help, and encouragement at the death of a loved one. We may listen to a piece of music they enjoyed, like AC/DC. We may visit a place we shared together. We may read a letter they wrote to us. We may thumb through a photo album, remembering again all the things we shared. We may find something of our loved ones and keep it close to us. Some people find comfort in the words of a poem, words from the Bible or an old hymn. There are many ways in which each of us find help, strength, and encouragement and the death of a loved one. And for each of us, these things will be different, just as the way in which we respond will be different for each of us. We may want to spend time by ourselves. We may find we easily get frustrated and angry and a little less tolerant than usual. We may want to keep our friends, our family close. There are many ways in which we each may respond where we find help, strength, and encouragement. Today, as we come together to celebrate the life of Garry, we will need extra strength and courage to get us through. We will remember all the good times, the great moments we shared and which make us laugh and feel good. But at the same time, we realise we are saying goodbye, which causes us to feel sad, and naturally and understandably, we may cry. We will need each other's support, care and strength as we celebrate Garry's life. And to help us to do that, there are a number of people that are going to bring their memories and reflections. I'd like to invite Katie Robbins, Garry's daughter, and good friend Frank Zeigler to come and share some thoughts with us. Thank you, Katie and Frank.
Thank you, everyone, for coming today. Our dad, the apple of our eye, our hero, the glue that holds us all together. From the day Justin and I were born, Dad made sure his family was his number one priority. He never raised his voice at us once. He always made sure we had everything we needed, even giving up his favourite things so we never missed out. Now, I'm not going to sugarcoat this. We all know he was a shit stirrer, a joker, and a prankster. So growing up with Garry Mallen as your dad meant you had to be prepared for anything. Dad would continually find some way to embarrass us, even as adults, but as kids, it was next level. Public places were the worst for us, but not for Dad. This was his playground. Dad would go missing. This meant the game had started. You had to always be aware of your surroundings because something was about to go down. From hiding in clothes racks, flicking all the clothes off, scaring the life out of us as we walked past, to food sliding under the Woolworths aisles, hitting your feet, we would also find Dad in shop windows, pretending to be a mannequin while pulling faces was a common occurrence. How Dad was never kicked out of a shop was beyond us. Believe it or not, Dad hated losing when playing games with us. He would always find a way to win. The card game, you know. Simple, right? I didn't know at the time, but he had mastered cheating at the game. He even mastered cheating at most of the games we all played. Dad always won, or so we thought. If Dad didn't win at a game, he would say, "I'm not playing now, you cheated." It would always make us laugh. Growing up, we went on so many holidays and camping trips. We had the best childhood. But as we got older, we got our own caravans. So this meant it was competition time. It was a case of who had what worked the best, and who had the latest gadgets. For example, who had the best solar panels, to who had the best lighting system. Mum, Lauren and I would sit back on our camping chairs and watch Dad, Justin and Robbo go from one camp to the other, comparing their setup as we watched the competition unfold. Guaranteed, the next camping trip, Dad would have purchased something the boys didn't have so he could bring it at the next camping trip and surprise them. I swear this was the highlight of his trips. As we all know, Dad was a fantastic storyteller. Whether it was true or not was a different story. Me being the gullible one in the family, Dad would tell me many stories on how certain bridges were built to how certain things were made. I believed every story he told me. And I would go and tell all the kids at school, my friends would look at me funny, and in the end they would say, "Did your dad tell you that?" Dad would say the same stories to Harvey, Ruby and Rye. Fortunately for them, they would look at Mum, who would be shaking her head and have to explain that it's just not true. Pa's telling fibs again. Now I have a little story to tell you about a little brown paper bag. Some of you have heard this story as Dad would bring it out on many occasions. About 30 years ago, Dad went to a fishing shop in Geelong. He brought some fishing tackle. He handed over a $50 note, which was a lot of money back then, and the shop assistant put his change and his tackle in a small brown paper bag. When he got back to his cousin's house, he realised that the shop assistant had ripped him off. Dad called the shop and explained he was ripped off. The shop assistant said he wouldn't know until he counted his till that night, and he would ring Dad back. He never rang Dad back. Dad didn't have his receipt, so he kept the bag, which is perfectly folded in his wallet, and I don't want to like get the folding wrong, but this is a 30-year-old bag that he has kept, and Dad would not hesitate to bring this little brown paper bag out and tell you all about the story of the day that he was ripped off. Better fold it properly back in there. My dad was many things, but one that stands out the most was you could always rely on him. He was the most reliable person I had ever met. No matter what the situation was, he would always be there for us and would always firstly make sure we were okay before assessing the trouble we had gotten up to. Dad had a way of fixing absolutely everything, from the smallest things to the biggest. He once said to one of my friends, when I broke the Commodore 64, showing my age, "If you want something broken, just give it to Katie." I don't know if it was because I went to him for every problem possible, or I do break everything, but he was always there to help me in every situation. We will forever have a hole in our hearts, Dad. You would fill the room with so much love and laughter. Not only have we lost our dad, we have lost our best friend. I'm going to read this little poem that I found. It's called Hero Dad. You are my hero, Dad. You are my secure foundation. When I think of you, I'm filled with love and a fond appreciation. You make me feel protected. I'm sheltered by your care. You're always my true friend, and Dad, when I need you, you're always there. You have a place of honour deep within my heart. You've been my superhero, Dad, right from the very start. Thank you.
Beautiful, Mel.
Thank you.
Garry James Mallen, Mal Wrinkle. I'm honoured and humbled to be asked to be present to deliver this eulogy today on behalf of Garry's family. Garry, the son, the husband, the father, uncle, grandpa, and mate, is such a person who, if you were lucky enough to have known Garry, even for a short time, be far the better for the time spent with him. Now we will count our blessings for the time we've been able to share with him and his family. Garry was the son of Marion and Graham Mallen and was born on the 12th of July in 1957 in Coleraine. Garry was the firstborn and elder sibling to Jeff, then Neville, deceased, Wendy, Peter and Doug. Unfortunately for the family, the loss of Garry's father, Graham, whom at only 47 years of age passed away, leaving Garry as the head of the family. Garry attended the Coleraine local school, and his larrikin ways had already surfaced when, as milk monitor, Garry took the lids off the small individual third pint bottles provided to all primary school kids, and he licked the cream off the tinfoil lids and then put them back on. The family moved to Blair Street in Portland, and Garry attended the Portland High School, working part-time amongst many things as a paperboy on the Blair Street round. He then left school at year 10. From the time he left school, he did not have a job to go to. Glenda affectionately recalls some wonderful memories of this time. bear with me, you need to picture Garry just out of school, not sure of a job, with extremely long hair down the middle of his back, wearing navy blue suede elevated platform shoes as a rock and roll drummer with the local band Fluid Drive. Yes, our Garry was a drummer boy, and the band supported local visiting groups, including Rush, Fat Daddy, Akadaka, Skyhooks, and many others. Before Glenda met Garry, Glenda went to a concert and she was interested in the lead singer. However, as fate calls, ended up with Garry instead. Glenda's face lights up with her recollection of this long past moment and how her journey with Garry has now commenced. A journey that has lasted a lifetime, and today, right today, is their 46th wedding anniversary. They have been together for 49 years. 2 years after they met one another, Glenda was diagnosed with Crohn's disease. Garry and Glenda would not be separated, and this was not a reason for them not to live their lives together. Glenda and Garry decide to leave Portland in search of adventure. A young couple in their blue E.H. Holden travelled to Broken Hill. Garry got a job at Yelka Station, as a station hand, managed by Glenda's sister, Kay, and Max Pop. And as you know, Broken Hill is, hot, dry, and arduous. So think of this, boy, drummer boy, man. Glenda recalls Max saying, Garry's long hair had to go, so it was cut off. The navy blue suede platform elevated boots were exchanged for working boots. And he absolutely loved the work and being in the outback. He would do anything and love the variety of the work. Imagine this, living in a tin shed, 40 degrees Celsius temperatures or hotter every day and no air conditioning. Times were extremely hard. Then in 1977, Justin was born. Garry was just 20 and Glenda was 19. And Glenda recalls we've moved back into Broken Hill in case the flying doctor service did not make it out to the birth of Justin in time. The Broken Hill Racing Club proved to be a job option. And there was only one big meeting a year, the St. Patrick's Day races. Garry commences and works around the track, and on the day of the races, finds a very large bag of money well hidden. As is typical of Garry, we know, our Garry, even with both of them starving, he hands the bag complete into the authorities. Then Garry was asked if he knew how to operate a ride-on mower. Yeah, says Garry. Now picture our long-haired drummer boy astride a ride-on mower in a shed, rolling a cigarette. Glenda is asked to open the shed door to let Garry out, and Garry drives out and destroys the ground's watering hoses. That job was over. Glenda's ongoing treatment with Crohn's disease meant Garry's number one priority, his love, Glenda. They would both sit in waiting rooms over many hours, many treatments, inseparable. The doctor who used to treat Glenda first called Garry Mr. Mallen. However, over 2 years of treatment from this doctor, it went from Mr. Mallen to Garry and then Gaz. He was always positive. Garry said, I've married a lemon, but it's too late to change now. There was never doubt the love between the two was inseparable and absolute. Garry would help anyone. It's just his nature. Both Glenda and Garry were staying at the CWA hostel in two single beds with a cradle. One of the women staying in the hostel asked if Garry could drive her in the morning to the railway station. Garry, as could be expected, said yes. And early the next morning, they go to get in the blue E.H. Holden, and Garry puts the suitcase in the rear, and the woman gets in the passenger's seat. And when Garry looks to his left at her, she has her neck bent over onto her shoulder because the roof has been kicked in. Well, this apparently in Broken Hill at the time was what errant youths did, stomped on the roof of cars. Garry never worried about it. He said, get out of the car, gets in the front seat with his legs, kicks the roof out and says, get back in, and then drives to the station. Garry tried for every job he could, and he always wanted to be a radio announcer and put in for the job. Unfortunately, he didn't get the job, so now we'll never hear, hello world, this is Garry Mallen. He also got a job delivering kegs to all the pubs in Broken Hill, which is a lot, and he did this only for a few weeks, but it wasn't for Garry. Glenda says, "I will always remember when Garry came home from work at any time, he'd always pick Justin up, even when he was fast asleep, and cuddle him. Garry simply adored Justin and thought he was the luckiest man in the world. Even though there was very little money and lots of bills, there were no defaults. Glenda always received a red rose every week. Glenda asked Garry why. What does a red rose mean? Garry said, they represent love. She asked, why one? Gary's answer was that $1.50 each, you're only going to get one. Glenda smiles and says for 30 years he would put a chocolate on my pillow every morning when I was sleeping, and he had to go to work early as he did every day. The family returned to Portland and Garry got a job at SE Land, which was the biggest hardware and builder supplies business in town. Garry did sales and helped everyone, inside work and out. He did plastering, painting, tiling, decking, home improvements, carpentry, plumbing, electrical work, and any task you could imagine. Garry would learn as he went. He'd look at problems and work out how to make things work. He helped a lot of people. He worked hard, and then the couple looked towards buying their first home. Things were not easy, but Gary's work ethic meant he would help others with building works out of hours and made ends meet. With his love of family, Garry also had a love of community, and he had another career wish that was to be a paid firefighter. So Garry joined the Portland Volunteer Fire Brigade, and you'll hear of his achievements later. But he selflessly served in every imaginable role, and always things were the better for his being a part of them. He was affectionately known as Wrinkle at the Fire Brigade. More joy arrives in the Mallen household where in September 1982, Katie was born, which now, so using the term Mal, which is Glenda's affectionate name for Garry, adores Katie as much as Justin. From here, life is very busy, and of course, with Mal, there is always something interesting happening. For example, the E.H. Holden had a broken windscreen. Big cost for a new one. So easy to fix, thinks Mal. However, let's buy one of those plastic emergency windscreen. They're cheap. It works really well for 3 weeks until going a bit fast down a hill, it came off and wrapped around his head. Mal then had to fix it and went to the wreckers where he bought a replacement for only $20. After SE Land, Mal started with Lowther's cleaning service and worked hard. He rose to the position of supervisor and had a company car. Next, Prestige got the contract for the aluminium smelter and Mal sought a job. The immediate answer was when do you start? He was there for many years. He was always by the book. He was shy of public speaking. You might not have thought that. He would not even use a drive-through to order takeaways. However, in front of hundreds of people in Melbourne at a huge conference, he represented the smelter and spoke of safety and his role at the smelter and achieved high acclaim. After 21 years, he left the smelter and worked for John and Heather Abbott at their laundry, still supporting Portland Aluminium. He'd drive every day to Point Henry for 9 months and was offered and reluctantly put into a supervisor and manager roles in the office. He later worked for Robertson Civil Services in the same roles, cleaning and management and fixing things. Mal built and rebuilt all of the family homes, including their cottage at Narrowong, where they lived for 17 years, and then he upgrades to the family's new home in Tamora Crescent. This is because Glenda sold their existing house. They lived there for 19 years before moving into Portland lifestyle. Highlights were many. In 2001, Mal provided cleaning and management services to the Australian Open, and for 14 days straight, it was very hard work over long hours. And in his incredible style, Mal even provided Cliff Richard personal delivery of his towels. Now, Gavin's sporting career, these words are from Kevin Farley. Mal started his football umpiring career in 1989, travelling all over Victoria with the Western District Umpires Association, chalking up over 160 games in 8 years. Lots of road trips and fun times were had with the fellow umpiring mates, especially on the trips home which could sometimes take a while due to the numerous water holes frequented on the way. From 1997 to 2000, Mel was a club umpire for the Tirindarra Football Club, notching up four senior grand finals. After a break, he joined the newly formed South West Umpires Association in 2002 and never looked back. His umpiring went to another level and was awarded the 2002 Senior Grand Final and also won the coveted Golden Whistle Award, which is the highest achievement for any umpire. From this, he went on to do six Senior Grand Finals in a row, taking his tally to 10 Senior Grand Final games in the South West Football League. An outstanding achievement showing just how dedicated he was to umpiring. And over his umpiring career, he won numerous awards, including the President's Award, Most Consistent, he won that three times, the Coach's Award for his outstanding contribution to umpiring and the game. He also served on the committee for several years as Secretary and Treasurer. Sadly, after 320 games, Mal retired. He was such a character, happy-go-lucky, always up for a chat and a laugh, and always willing to help a colleague out when in need. Rest in peace, Mal, from past and present members of the Western District Football Umpires Association. Garry also had a love of fishing and was a member of the Portland Angling Club and Cable Trams. His long-time fishing mate, Charles, was his companion for over 20 years and has sadly passed away. Family holidays, different state, every year they love camping. The Mallens had a big van. It was pulled by a little Gemini, and Justin remembers the mirrors weren't quite wide enough and it had no electric brakes, but we always got there and back safely. Glenda reflects on Mal with these words: he'd make me laugh, cry, laugh, always by my side. And Gary's mother says, I'm very proud of Garry. It makes me so proud to hear all of his achievements. From 14 years old, he was the head of the house and all his siblings look up to him. And Louise's words are from Justin. My old man, supportive and caring, always ready to lend a hand and have a laugh. Most of the time, you were the butt of your own jokes, which made it even funnier, but you didn't care as long as you got a smile or a head shake. You made no judgment on mistakes, only to say, well, you won't do that again, and would just move on. You were grounded and strong, yet soft and caring, all the good attributes of a good person and father. You definitely left a legacy that I'll honour the best that I can, and I'll pass that down to my boys. I've made a promise to myself that when I hear your name, I won't be sad. I'll smile instead because I knew I grew up with the best old man a son could have. I'll miss you, mate. Oh, and don't let the yabbies bite. Rye also had his comments. My pa was always doing something funny and silly. I love my pa. And from Harvey, my pa was funny and naughty. Pa was always getting in trouble with Nan. In the Mallen household, when happy birthday is sung, Garry's voice will always be heard. Son, brother, husband, father, uncle, grandpa and mate, Garry James Mallen, wrinkle, pa, mate, rest in peace.
Now I'd like to invite CFA Chief Officer Jason Heffernan to come and speak in an acknowledgement in line of duty.
Good afternoon. Firefighting and service to community emergency situations is shrouded by uncertainty, an ever-present danger, not knowing when the call will come, what it will involve, and how it will end. The emergencies to which our people respond and the services they provide to the community are as varied as life itself. To give of oneself, sacrifice, and for the want of nothing, render assistance in times of need is just a few personal attributes of a volunteer firefighter. One thing is constant throughout, and for all the qualities it takes to be part of our country fire authority: tact, loyalty, dexterity, observation, explicitness, gallantry, perseverance, and sympathy. Rare is the individual who heads towards danger, and rarer still is the individual who does so only to serve a community they love and are connected to. Today, we recognise the death in the line of duty of Garry James Mallen of the Portland Fire Brigade and enshrine his name with the 81 other men and women of CFA and preceding organisations who gave their lives in service to their community. No one serves alone. When a CFA member answers the call to action, their loved ones are answering that call too. Every member is supported by a family who also gives of themselves, who sacrifice so much so that others may be safe and secure. To the family of Garry, Glenda, Katie, Justin, and to his many grandchildren, I thank you for your service. On behalf of Jacinda Allen, Premier of the State of Victoria, Minister for Emergency Services and Attorney General Jacqueline Slimes, Mr. Greg Wilson, Chair of the Authority, Executive Management, Senior Leadership, Districts, Groups, Brigades, of some 52,000 members across the State of Victoria, the Country Fire Authority, we offer our sincere condolences. Today we will hear Garry contributed significantly to CFA, an exceeding 39 years of diligent service, starting as a junior with the Portland Fire Brigade in 1972. Garry remained active and performed many roles, including Portland Captain, Apparatus Officer, 4th Lieutenant, Group Delegate. Spending a period of time with the Narrowong Brigade, he performed the roles of 2nd Lieutenant, Brigade Training Coordinator, and Deputy Group Officer for the Hayward Group. As a delegate to the District 4 Planning Committee, he shared his knowledge, leadership, and experience for the betterment of the district and as a confidant for senior officers on leadership. From a young age, Garry had competition running in his veins, competing both in the junior and senior segments. An advocate for succession planning and developing the next generation of CFA leaders, Garry was a captain peer mentor, where her newly elected and aspiring brigade officers would seek his counsel and guidance. He was an integral part of the brigade, group and district and served his community and fellow brigades loyally and with great enthusiasm, pride and professionalism. At 7:35 hours in the morning of the 30th of January 2024, as he has done so many times before, Garry's pager activated to a shed fire in Short Street, Portland. And upon making the dash to the door, his last words were, "Glenda, well, I'll be back in a moment. It's only a shed fire." Whilst performing firefighting duty and operations at the shed fire, Garry collapsed, and despite the very best efforts of firefighters and ambulance personnel, he could not be revived. I had the honour of sitting with Glenda, Katie and Justin to listen to their reflections on a loving husband, a dedicated father. Garry and Glenda, as we heard, met as young teenagers and were together for 49 years. We heard about the long-haired drummer boy, and we recounted stories of, you know, supporting and playing with ACDC, Ted Mulray gang, whenever they played in Portland. Legend has it he still best mates with ACDC. Well, that's according to Garry, at least. Loving and caring husband who stood by Glenda when she herself was recently critically ill, staying by her side day in, day out, particularly while she was in a coma, until the day he died was still tending to her medical needs. Loved by CFA and his mates, travelled to monthly DPC meetings at Digby and didn't get home till late and still went to work the next morning. Garry always tried to achieve and make a better life for himself and his family. He was never spiteful or jealous. He renovated two homes and was always building and fixing things, and as we heard, loved gadgets, and was an umpire for his love and loved doing what he did, and retired from umpiring when he achieved his Golden Whistle Award. In the firefighting sense, he looked up to his Uncle Reg, who was a recipient of the Australian Fire Service Medal and was an inspiration to Garry in his firefighting duties. The Outstanding Service Award is a medal of antique silver in colour and the shape of the Fire Service's star. In the centre is the CFA emblem with red shield and suspended from a bar engraved with the words, Outstanding Service. The bar is attached to a ribbon edged in red and a thin white stripe inside the red margins. An antique silver Victorian state emblem is attached to the centre of the ribbon. The Outstanding Service Medal recognises prolonged service distinguished by exceptional performance. It is CFA's most prestigious internal award outside of valour and bravery. For these reasons, the Honours and Awards and Remembrance Committee of the Authority has seen fit to today bestow upon Garry James Mallen CFA's Outstanding Service Medal. In addition to the Outstanding Service Medal, Garry James Mallen is to be bestowed the 35-year service medal with life membership. This award consists of a circular medal with a CFA emblem contained in a rim of scroll carrying the words life member. The emblem is superimposed on the fire star, which is based on the eight-pointed star of St. John. Each point of the star separately represents the virtues considered to represent the qualities of a firefighter. So the star was chosen of the insignia as many fire services. This medal is suspended by a bar carrying the coat of arms of the state of Victoria and attached to a ribbon of red and white squares symbolising the CFA logo. On the reverse of the medal are the words, in recognition of service to the Country Fire Authority of Victoria. I will present this award, both Outstanding Service Medal, Long Service and Life Membership today. However, when I reflect on the loving story shared by Glenda and her family, I'm reminded of a poem that I think will sum up Garry and his dedication to service and family, and if you'll indulge me, I care to read it now. It's entitled A Firefighter's Farewell. If you cry a tear for me, remember that though it seems death has conquered, I do not fear, for I have lived the life of my dreams. Being a firefighter was my calling, a hope and a dream fulfilled, and I was blessed to save many others, courage combined by my skill. And I know when I meet my maker, my God will be satisfied that I've created for others more than myself through a lifetime of service. For I've battered the tortured infernos, sought for the wounded, trapped and afraid. I still feel deep sorrow for those that I've lost, and the greatest joy for those of the community I have saved. And though it breaks my heart to leave you, I want my life to always be a reminder of how much I loved you, my family, my friends, my CFA. For in the eyes of every person that I helped, there I see reflections of you. You were the source of my bravery, my commitment, my love, and to my fellow Portland members too. So having lived the life of my dreams, my body now in peace, now I can rest and my spirit rejoice in heaven while I still watch over whom I have all loved and served. I now call forward Staff Officer for the presentation of awards.
Now I'd like to call forward John Jugum, Assistant Chief Fire Officer, to explain some of Garry's recognition of service. Thanks, John.
I'd like to acknowledge and thank Garry's family, in particular Glenda, Katie and Justin, for supporting Garry's involvement as a dedicated volunteer with CFA for nearly 40 years. Thank you. Garry joined the Country Fire Authority as a junior in 1972 and was an active member of the Portland Brigade Running Club, where he relished the competitions. And he won many events. Running was something that he particularly enjoyed. On completion of his junior membership in 1975, Garry took a break from CFA, eventually moving interstate to live and work in the outback, as we've heard. In 1987, Garry returned to the Portland Brigade and quickly became an active member, establishing himself as a skilled and competent and dedicated firefighter, attaining apparatus officer status in 1990. Garry always strove to better himself and others in the brigade, and in 1994 he was elected second lieutenant, a key position that would help him develop into a future captain. However, Garry's membership at Portland was interrupted when he and his family, Glenda, Katie and Justin, moved to Narrewong to a larger home with more space. Once in Narrewong, Garry joined the local brigade in 1998 and was a member there until December 2005. During his time there, Garry again stepped up to leadership roles, taking on second lieutenant, brigade training officer as well. In these roles, Garry excelled, helping many develop their skills and knowledge of firefighting. Garry was a highly valued member of the Narrewong Brigade. Following his family's move back to Portland in 2005, Garry returned to his original brigade to the delight of the Portland members. The next period in his volunteer career would see Garry make an indelible mark on the history of the Portland Brigade, rising to Captain and District Planning Committee Delegate from 2010 to 2016. Garry's contribution to the Portland Brigade was recognised with being awarded Firefighter of the Year in 2010, which in typical fashion he humbly accepted and never boasted about. It should be said that this award is made for exceptional attendance, efforts in responding to emergencies and leadership within the brigade, all hallmarks of Garry's approach. During Garry's time as captain, he personally assisted and trained firefighters in structural firefighting, building Portland's capability, and also in breathing apparatus skills at the Penshurst training facility. Garry was also an active mentor, as we've heard, with the CFA's Captain Peer Mentoring Program, assisting in the development of many captains. I'm sure there's some here today. Probably Garry's biggest fire as captain was the fire on board the livestock carrier Awassi Express in 2015. Fire crews were called to reports of smoke billowing from a ship on Tuesday night, November 3rd. And arrived to find 800 tonnes of grain on fire on board the Awassi Express. I think we can all imagine what Garry's words would have been when he saw that. But Garry's quick and decisive actions as the first officer on scene were critical to the safe operations that took place and eventual extinguishment of that fire some days later. It's a credit to his approach in handling the brigade and his members. The Haywood Group of Brigades also benefited from Garry's efforts with his election as Group Health and Safety Officer from 2018 to 2022, 6th Deputy Group Officer and Group Delegate from 2018. And these roles are important and take in a broader responsibility across more than just your local brigade. And they assist many brigades and the district to deliver services to the community. Garry excelled in all roles and with his typical no-fuss approach, was able to achieve things. Garry received the CFA's 20-year badge in 2007, and in 2022, his 35-year service medal. Service medals are awarded for efficient service over a sustained period of not less than 10 years. And as we've seen with Garry's service, it well exceeds the 10 years. In 2011, Garry was awarded the National Medal and First Clasp, which is part of the Australian Honours and Awards nomination system. The National Medal recognises long and diligent service by members of government and voluntary organisations that risk their lives and safety to protect and assist the community in enforcement of the law in times of emergency or natural disaster. Today, we've also seen Garry awarded CFA Life membership for his exemplary dedication, commitment and contribution to CFA over almost 40 years. We also heard the Chief Award Garry, CFA's Outstanding Service Medal, recognising prolonged service distinguished by exceptional performance. This underscores an outstanding contribution of 756 turnouts over nearly 40 years of service from an exceptional man who will be sadly missed by us all and remembered always. Thank you.
Now I'd like to call on Ryan Delony, the CFA Portland Fire Brigade Captain. Thank you, Ryan.
Garry, also known as Mal, Dad, Pa, and Wrinkle. When I think of the man, there would be several words that I could describe him, including but not limited to gentle, caring, paternal, silly, carefree, devoted, family man, larrikin, mentor, calm, leader, and humble. Specifically, with Garry being humble. Buck Palmer and I met with Glenda and Katie after a few days had gone by. We both had a similar reaction of shock, as it's almost as Garry had lived several lives, the stories they were telling us, all brilliant. We were blown away with how much this man had done and achieved, yet not once pumped his own tyres or spruiked them to anyone. There was also the clear overlap of the way he brought up his children and grandchildren. Katie explained that he had not once raised his voice to them growing up, and upon reflection within the brigade, he'd never done this either. Garry was a wise head the brigade relied upon and was also there to help. We have the shared experience of Garry also farting and then proceeding to ask everyone, do you smell petrol? He was such a character. In a sense, the brigade and the community has lost a father we never realised we had. His commitment to his brigade and its members cannot be replaced and will be missed as it will be honoured. In closing, this man, Garry, the cornerstone of his family, the brigade and the community. Now, if you're unaware of what a cornerstone is, it's the first stone set in a building. All other stones will be set in reference to this, thus determining the position of the entire structure. Glenda, Katie, Justin, Paul, Lauren, Ruby, Rye, and Harvey will ensure the memory of this great man will not be forgotten and he will continue on to be our cornerstone into the future.
We're now going to watch a photo tribute of Garry.
turn around. Wanna turn around once and we'll do the eagle run.
Today, through words and pictures, we've been given a glimpse of the real Garry, a man who liked to joke and have fun, a man who worked hard to care and support his family, a man who gave back to his community, a man who lived and believed in the virtues of respect and honesty. These words and pictures have no doubt resonated with our own memories and experiences of Garry and brought his image freshly before us. For Garry's family and extended family, we are thankful for Garry's love for them. And even though some memories may fade, Garry's love will continue to grow with them, leading them into fulfilling lives. Today, we have remembered and celebrated Garry's life. We've remembered some of his characteristics and qualities. We have reflected on the things he has taught us, the things he has given us, and in the many ways he is still a part of us, particularly through the family. We are thankful for good times, for encouragement and support and love in our relationship with him. We are sorry if we have hurt or disappointed him, and forgive him if he has hurt us. We now need courage to grieve realistically and to face the pain of saying goodbye. I'd invite you now to stand for the words of committal. Seeing that the earthly life of Garry has come to an end, we commit his body to be cremated, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. What has come from the earth goes back to the earth, so the cycle of life continues. Having completed this final task, may we go forth in quiet with a measure of peace, so that we may live out our lives with renewed memory and with deepened love for one another. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to invite Adrian Gucci to come and speak to us. Adrian is the Deputy Chief Officer for the South West Region. Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you for allowing me the honour of presenting the evergreens. For everyone, tables with the evergreens have been provided at the rear of the entry foyer, at the exit doors and near the fire truck outside. I would ask that you please take an evergreen and place it onto the table besides Garry's portrait and his effects outside. Fellow firefighters, we remember this day our colleague Garry Mallen, who shared our pleasures, hopes, and misfortunes. We remember him as we knew him, serving in our ranks, answering many calls, leaving comfort, security, and safety to render service to all. From the dying embers of his life, we shall kindle a new flame and pass it on from member to member, as a symbol that the life we honour will go on in service through those who this day are humbled before eternity and dedicated to help our community through service with the Country Fire Authority. To symbolise our memories, we leave here these evergreens. Thank you.
May the care, love, and support of family and friends strengthen, comfort, and support us as today we face a changed world. Amen. The members of the Portland Fire Brigade, please come forward. Please be upstanding.
Kalapati, inward, turn. Kalapati, lift. Kalapati, fold. And fold. Kalapati, right and left turn. Kalapati to the flags, quick march. Kalapati, hop. Kalapati, left turn.
Thank you. Guard. party, Carrie Keller.
Oh, yeah.
No, well, this can go for the you'll be the start. We're not going to, you're already meeting, we're going to still mark out for the
Keller party by the centre. Quick march.
Oh, no. Oh, that's a big grandson.